Board, position three. We have over on the left, Howard Sharples, and on the right, Alan Warner. And they each will have two-minute opening statement, starting with Mr. Sharples. 2 minutes.
My name is Howard Sharples. I'm glad to be here tonight. I'm married, have three grown children. I was born in Tucson, Arizona. I grew up in California, and we moved here about 24 years ago. I just retired a couple of years ago from teaching in Council School District. I was a teacher for 25 years. Before that, I was a locomotive engineer for Southern Pacific Railroad Company. And I think that the career change was probably the best thing that I ever did. I told people very often that teaching was the hardest job I ever had and the only one I ever loved. So right now I'm serving out an expired term. We had a resignation on the Council School Board, and I interviewed for the job and was awarded that job last January. And it's been a wonderful experience, and I hope to continue to serve the Council School District.
Mr. Warner?
Yes, my name is Alan Warner. I'm originally from Washougal, Washington, not too far from here, where I grew up. I came here and I got married, and I started working for the Long Peak School District. I work with the Spanish-speaking population there, and I work as a liaison and a member of quite a variety of activities there, and was exposed to a lot of different facets of the education system. And what I did with administrators and teachers and different staff at different levels and PTOs and so forth. I finally decided that it was time to stop talking about what should be different in the education system and do something about it. And so I decided to take this chance to run the school board. And have ideas, and hopefully some of them are good.
Okay, thank you. The first question, each of the candidates will get 2 minutes to answer the question. What are the school-related issues that concern you, and what would be your approach to that, starting with Mr. Sharples?
School-related issues? Could you be a little more specific? Are you talking about economic issues? Are you talking about curriculum issues?
Whatever are the ones that concern you.
Well, right now the Council School Board is getting ready to try to pass it on next year. The facilities improvement team has been working on the plan for months now, and they've finally come down to a decision about how much they're going to ask. Many of our buildings are really showing their age, and so there are not only structural issues involved, but sometimes we're talking about security issues. So it's important that we get the bond passed next year.
Okay. Mr. Warner, same question.
Yeah, thank you. First, I want to say that I am proud to have my kids in the Council School District. I'm proud they've gone there. I'm very pleased with the education they've gotten. This is a good school district. It's I'm happy with, in general, the way it's run. I'm not running because it's a poorly run district, just because I think I have some ideas that I don't hear elsewhere. And the top concerns, of course, facilities is an important concern, and other concerns that the district has already addressed. I would like to see further involvement from the teachers in the design process of planning from the ground up. I think we ignore their opinions too often, and as a group, they are the ones who are doing the work, who are seeing the problems, and say, but it seems like the more power people have over the process, the more distant they are from the classroom. And I think that's a real problem. I think we ought to be listening to what teachers have to say as we plan things. I also think we should pay more attention to what parents and have to say about schools. And I'd like to see more parent involvement in the planning and process. I also, it's not something we can change here at district level, but I think we should start talking and maybe collaborating with other districts on how to change the reform system, basically. We've been trying to reform education for some years now, and I don't think it has gotten us anywhere, and I think it's just led to frustration and problems, created more problems than solved. The SBA, for example, is a poor way of measuring student performance. It's one test a year, and basically all it tells you is whether students are above the world average, the historical average. And I think there are better ways of measuring teacher success. I think we ought to look for those. The public has demanded that teachers and schools be held accountable for their school outcomes.
Okay. Yep, that's your two
words.
Okay, right.
So for the next question, Mr. Warner will go first. What experience dealing with big budgets and policy planning would you bring to the school board?
My only experience I have with big budgets is seeing them done. I've been an avid reader of the news and following politics for a very long time. Policy planning, I have been able to see a lot of that done, and I find that when I make comments, they're often well received, and so I have confidence in those.
Okay, Mr. Shovels, same question.
Any experience I've had with big budgets is what I've obtained just since I've been on the board, since January. It's been an awakening. I've never had to look at so many numbers and try to make sense out of them. It's given me a whole new respect for our business manager. He's quite a talent. The second question, or the second part of the question was what?
Policy planning.
Policy tends to come from the state. They hand down, you know, what's going to be required, and we have to figure out how to make that work in the district.
Okay, the next question will be back to Mr. Sharples to begin with. How do you believe that schools should support students with mental health issues?
Mental health issues. We have a fairly extensive staff that dedicated to dealing with students with special needs. From the most basic as far as counseling to dealing with students who are, if we have a student who is essentially taken care of by two aides and a teacher. And that's one of the problems with funding a special education, that the federal government and the state only give us a certain amount of money, and we end up as a district having to spend quite a bit more in order to meet the needs of these students.
Okay, same question, Mr. Warren.
Yeah, I think that's a very good question. It's a big deal. In general, we look at kids' performance and we see what they can do. I think it's a bad idea I don't think you can accurately measure how much a person can lift unless you can also measure how much weight they're carrying on their back. And some of our students are carrying quite a bit of weight on their backs. We have one of the highest incarceration rates in the state in this county. We have a high rate of mental illness in this county. We have a high rate of drug use in this county. So we have a number of students, probably a higher percentage as on a county level than most other counties in the state. And so a lot of those are related to mental health issues. I think, though, as Howard mentioned, budgets is a huge problem here. Schools do what they can. The only way we're going to get the only way we can address it better, I think we need to get a handle on the problem first. We need to get better at identifying the problems earlier. We need to be able to see the effects of trauma in our kids and the problems they're dealing with, and need to be able to say, look, this is what's going on. This is how many of our kids are struggling with these issues, and this is how it's affecting their education. This is how it affects our community. And so once, if we can show that this is a big problem, then we can start getting support to do something about it.
Okay, the next question will begin with Mr. Warner. Do you support exposure to the trades for students in high school? And if so, what would be your plan to achieve this goal?
Absolutely, yes, thank you. That is actually a big deal. I noticed the district is already moving on this topic, I believe. They're working on getting some back. I admire the German approach to education. I actually know someone who is from Germany and did an apprenticeship in high school. And because in Germany, the last 2 years of school can either be college preparation or an apprenticeship, and that works a lot better for their students. They get work experience, because by the time you're a junior, you have a good idea whether you're going to college or not. And so if we could do that here, we could get kids in the workplace in their junior year, start getting work experience, then they would be a lot more prepared for the next step, and they'd be more likely to stay in school. I mean, we have kids, they know that they're not going to be using algebra as well in their life. Although algebra does teach logic and is very useful, but they're taking classes that are college prep classes, and they're aware of that, and they aren't motivated to finish them, aren't motivated to study, but if we could put them in as a work program, then we could. Of course, as Howard mentioned, the state sets a lot of our rules. We can only go so far, but I think we should work towards that as far as we can, and in general, we should collaborate with other districts and try to encourage legislators to adjust the system when necessary.
Okay. Mr.
Sharples,
same question?
We've already got at Tulsa High School a fairly extensive CTE program. In fact, we had our teachers building with our kids building portable classrooms to be used in the district. And currently, the superintendent is working on setting up an apprenticeship program with businesses in the community. Apprenticeships are a terrific way for kids to, you know, move into the workplace and learn the skills that they need to have in order to be a success in life.
Okay, the next question will start with Mr. Sharples. What safety measures would you include in facilities planning?
Well, security measures, first of all, the outside perimeter must have some kind of integrity. When Kelso High School went through its remodel, it limited the number of access points to the school. So that right now, I mean, people should only be able to get into the building through the main front doors. Now, sometimes we had kids, you know, block open a door, but the security cameras would often pick up that situation and we take care of it. So first of all, then outside integrity. And then we regularly had drills, lockdown drills, intruder drills. Give the kids some practice. This is what happens when there's a problem, when there's a safety issue. And look what happened here, this recent shooting in Freeman, Washington, just today. And it had a terrible outcome. One person is dead, three are wounded, but it may have been much worse. You know, they had a lockdown drill yesterday. It's just one of those things. And so the kids knew what to do in the situation. It may have prevented more injuries.
Okay, Mr. Warner, same question?
Yes, the most of the same points is the restricting access, and I think that's one of the reasons they want to replace Beacon Hill Elementary, because these classrooms are all exposed to the outside. There is, every classroom is exposed to outdoors, pretty much. And that is a real safety issue. The only thing I would add is that it's a rather minor point. We're all thinking about safety as school shootings because that's what scares us. And I would just add, I would like to put cameras on the playgrounds and not like cameras on playgrounds at night. And that's rather a minor issue because that concern is because of things that are left there overnight, occasionally on some of the playgrounds, condoms, needles, graffiti, and that's just, if we had cameras on the playgrounds, we could have a chance to figure out who did it, and that would be a deterrence. And I just think it's kind of an obvious obvious thing to do to try and fix that problem. Just put some cameras on or outside, and we can kind of keep those playgrounds a little safer. But I think that the elementary schools do.
Next question starts with Mr. Warner. How do you keep students safe from bullying, and is the Kelso School District doing enough?
Well, I don't know that any school district is really doing enough, partly because we aren't always sure what to do. I mean, everybody takes it seriously, but it's so hard. I think I was able to see the Talk, Walk, and Squawk program, which is developed here locally, which is seems to me to be an effective method. If they talk means the kids tell another kid to stop, so they take some responsibility for stopping it. Second, they walk away. They get away from the child, other child, remove themselves. And third, if that doesn't work, then they go talk to somebody. That seems like an effective method in general for dealing with problems like that. We have to kind of change the mentality of everybody as far as bullying. You know, they say there's three parts to bullying. There's the bully person who's doing the bullying. There's the victim, and there's the bystanders. And we tend to focus on the bullies and tell them not to bully. We also need to teach kids to stand up for themselves as much as we can. That should start in preschool, kindergarten, telling kids when they say, so-and-so hit me, well, you need to. What did you say to them afterwards? Did you tell them to stop? Did you tell them they didn't like it? And that's what became little to children. What did you say when they said that to you? There's a certain extent, it sort of almost requires consent from the person being bullied to be bullied. There's a certain amount of consent involved there, or what, but especially by the bystanders who are saying, you know, this is not saying anything, sending a message that this is okay. And so, like I said, no, I don't know that any school district is really doing enough on this. We can all do better, and I think that's sort of a framework to start with.
Mr. Sharples, same question?
What do you say? Yeah. First of all, the district needs to have a zero tolerance for bullying, and Kelso School District does. That's easy to say, it's hard to accomplish. You have to begin in the earliest grades and teach kids to have empathy and concern for others. As the kids mature, go through the grades, your programs for teaching empathy and concern, you know, become more sophisticated. Until, you know, by the time they're in high school, you can have some pretty serious and mature conversations with them about bullying and its consequences. I know there was a great fear over the program that came out last year, 13 Reasons Why. A lot of people objected to its use in the classroom. Other people saw that there was real value in dramatizing what happens when bullying occurs. As Alan indicated, when bullying does occur, these folks need to be counseled, and not just the bully, but the victim too. And ultimately, if you may reach a point where someone is resistant to counseling and insists on bullying and intimidating others, then we're going to have to find an alternative placement for them.
Okay, the next question starts with Mr. Sharples. This is an audience question. Do you support or oppose opening up union contract negotiations to the public? Why or why not?
I was asked this question by the Daily News, and I respond the way I responded to them. That puts me in a very awkward situation. Our board policy is that the board president speaks for the board. That's the policy. And if I say I support the policy, then it was very likely that the Daily News wouldn't want to give me their endorsement. On the other hand, if I say that I would like the policy to be open, then I'm undermining the people that I have to serve with, at least until November. So what I will say is I will happily embrace whatever policy the board chooses to make.
Okay, Mr. Warren?
Well, yeah, I also spoke with the Daily News and asked that question. Another question they asked was whether I thought we should change the policy about letting board members speak their mind outside of, if they disagree with the policy, and I think that that should be changed. It's really unfortunate that Howard cannot answer that question. So I would say that, in general, it makes it difficult. I cannot be a member of the school board, and I can say that, yeah, that makes that. Everyone has an interest in making sure that public funds are spent wisely and efficiently. Negotiations would be difficult to carry out in public. I like to see examples of that done successfully first. However, I am always in favor of greater transparency, and I think we should move towards more information from the public as much as we can, as much as is feasible. And I'd like to see if another school district has carried that out successfully.
I'm sorry, Sharon. I misunderstood your question. I've got my hearing aids in,
okay,
but I still misunderstood. You were asking about negotiations and not public comments?
Yeah. Do you oppose or support opening up the union contract negotiations to the public?
No, I would oppose open negotiations. Our superintendent had the experience in the district that he worked in before where it was a open negotiation public, and he saw that people would play the canvas, that they would, you know, dramatize something that didn't need to be dramatized. Negotiations are very messy, and you have both sides taking initial positions that may seem unfair or draconian to people outside the industry or the business. And, you know, generally speaking, as negotiations progress, there are enough people willing to talk about what's going on that the public knows and has at least some idea of what's happening behind closed doors.
Okay. So let's go to the next question, which should start with Mr. Warner. Recently, the dress code at Kelso High School has become an issue. A petition has been started online to make changes to the current dress code. What's your position on this? What do you think about this?
Well, it's interesting because I was thinking about my experiences in that issue myself as a student. I remember being in high school, and when I was in high school, the boys couldn't wear shorts, and the girls could wear skirts, and the boys thought that was unfair. And so they held a protest by wearing skirts to school. And yeah, and then I went to college. I actually went to a college that had a dress code. And have rather strict dress code, actually. And it was also a matter of controversy at the time. There were students pushing for changes. And again, one of the issues was men weren't allowed to wear shorts. And that was changed. And it had some odd, the changes weren't what the students wanted, but it was changed. So I think dress codes in general are always going to be a matter of controversy. I think it's hard to keep them up to date with standards of the time, and because the standards change from day to day, year to year, styles change. I think they need to be a matter of being updated regularly, although they're probably never going to be exactly what all students want. But yeah, updating them would be appropriate.
Okay, Mr. Sharples?
I agree with Mr. Warner. Dress codes very often are controversial, and kids will very often push the limits of the dress code. I know that teachers and administrators spend a great deal of time trying to determine what's going to be appropriate wear for schools. Certainly, they don't want to allow students to dress in such a way that the school was disrupted. At the same time, they will often make rules that the kids feel are unfair. And so, you know, dress codes evolve. It may be that this petition is successful and that the administrators listen and they may adjust their expectations, or they may, you know, have very good arguments about why they're enforcing the rules the way they are. I think at some point you have to trust the administrators and the teachers in the building. They're not trying to cheat the kids out of wearing their favorite clothes. They're just trying to maintain some kind of order.
Okay. Next question, we'll start with Mr. Sharples. And this comes from an online viewer because we're having this live stream. This is something different. Every year there's a significant challenge with head lice in Kelso. Do you have any solutions? What solutions would you propose?
You got me there. When our kids were in elementary school, at least on a couple different occasions, we got the note home that there's lice in the classroom, and I don't know, we had to go through the whole process of getting rid of the things. And so I don't know what to tell you there. You know, it seems to be one of those problems that just never goes away, not entirely.
Mr. Warner?
Yeah, that's I think what happened several years back is the state decided that lice was a nuisance, not an illness, and it stopped. It was no longer allowed as an excused absence to be absent for lice. And that created has policy is not always popular, but it's a state policy. But all we can do, I suppose, is notify people that there's lice in the classroom. There's only so much we can do after that. Education about what to do when you have lice. Everyone talks about shampoos, and those are losing effectiveness because of the lice becoming resistant. The best thing to do is actually use a comb, and put clothes in the dryer, or tie them up in bags, and do things like that. Everything you can to kill the lice. Lice have been around as long as they're good people, and they're not going to go away. No one wants them. It makes you itchy just thinking about them. With the state policy being what it is, there's only so much we can do.
Okay, next one. This is a little more serious question, starting with Mr. Warner. If you were to be a school board member, how would you convince voters to pass levies and bonds? How would you help that process?
That's a good question. I always think it's best to get people involved from the beginning. I know the school district does work on that. They get parents and community members on the facilities planning. And you need to make sure your goals are matching the community's goals, especially regardless of how much money they're going to spend. I'm thinking of my hometown, Washougal, where this town grew after I graduated, and they ended up building a new school. But first, they tried to pass a levy to build a new school, and it was rejected, so they finally ended up compromising on building on top of the existing structure, and that passed. I personally believe that schools are important, and the facilities are important, and that some things are worth sacrificing for. I think we need to explain it to, we need to get people to buy into the education as an expense, that it is worth it. And even if it hurts, it's worth it. Some things are just worth doing, even when they're hard. And we also need to make sure that the community believes that we are using their funds appropriately. That is one of the big issues. It's not that people aren't willing to spend the money, but they want to make sure it's really being used efficiently and appropriately and isn't being wasted. And so there has to be an effort on that as well to make sure that our goals, the community shares our goals, and trying to explain the importance of education and also make sure that we are being efficient with our dollars, with taxpayer dollars, and that we can improve that to taxpayers.
Okay, Mr. Sharples, same question.
One of the things that Council District has done with this upcoming bond issue is that they started with a thought exchange and they ran that for several days, weeks, I think, and they collected suggestions from community members about, you know, what would be your priority? You know, what are the things that you would like to see done? These are the questions of the community. And then the facility improvement team took those suggestions and began to craft a plan of what could be done, what should be done in the district. Now that they've settled on an amount of money that we're going to ask for, and they've got a basic plan in place, they're now starting up the thought exchange again to re-involve the community and make sure that everybody's headed in the right direction. As Mr. Warner points out, you know, you have to convince the community that they're getting the best that we can give them for their dollars. It's important that we, you know, continue to support the education of our kids. Finally, on a personal level, I've liked bond issues in the past and levies in the past. I'll be back out banging on doors and asking people to give us their support. So.
Okay, the next question, we'll start with Mr. Sharples. What is your stand on distance education?
On what?
Distance education, online.
Online education. Online education, I think it may work well for some students, but for the great majority of students, I think that they get a lot more from being in the classroom and exchanging ideas with other students. I've taken a few online classes myself, and while I was able to earn the credit that I needed to earn, I much prefer being in a classroom where a free exchange of ideas would take place. It was wonderful as a teacher to see kids engaged in conversations and discussions, dealing with weighty subjects, and I'm not sure that that's as meaningful or as powerful when you're doing it online. But it does have its place.
Mr. Warren?
In-class education has real advantages, and there are situations when it's easier for students, whereas online education may help students finish their degree. I've also taken some online classes, and I was thrilled by them. I wish I could have done all my college classes online because it was so much better for me. And so, especially students who are struggling in a school environment, students who may not be succeeding in a typical school environment, or students who are maybe ready to work at a faster pace. Those are all students who might be well served by distance education. And of course, in-class education there are real advantages to that. And human connection is very important. So we wouldn't want to ever make them equal in importance, I don't think.
Okay, so this is the final question, gentlemen. Starting with Mr. Warner. If anything were possible, describe your ideal school district.
Anything were possible. Ideal school district. So that we're talking about the schools in the school district, right? I assume. So if anything were possible, kindergarten would be age appropriate, and kids would be able to play and do things that are appropriate for their age and have expectations that are appropriate. We would be more concerned with the individual progress rather than average class score. We would be able to focus on things more than reading and math. We'd be able to focus on social studies and art. We'd have plenty of community support for funding, and we'd be able to help the kids who have special needs, kids who have mental health issues, and kids who have other issues, we'd be able to get the parents to work, support their kids at home and to support discipline policies, we'd work with the parents on discipline policies and their kids' education. We would have parent input in policy and we'd have the teacher input. We would be able to move forward and able to help each individual child, be able to individualize education. And then once kids get to old enough, they'd be able to choose between college and getting ready to be employed. Those are just some things that I would think would be ideal. Oh, we also be able to work with family literacy, family education. Kids can do better if we helped work with their parents when they're short on their education and can teach them English or help them complete their degrees or get education themselves.
Okay, Mr. Sharples, any questions?
The ideal or the perfect school district?
Your choice.
Okay. You know, I suppose the ideal school district is no kid comes to school hungry, no kid comes to school abused, every teacher is a master teacher, the community is always 100% behind the district, there's always enough money to take care of any problems that arise. That would be ideal. Unfortunately, you know, we deal in the real world, and it's so many of our kids come to school hungry and abused, and we do the best we can to educate them and to help them. I don't know a teacher worth his or her salt who isn't romantic at heart. We just feel like we can make a difference, and so we do all we can.
Okay. So now each of you will have 2 minutes for the closing statement, and I ask Mr. Warner to go first.
Okay. Just say again that I'm proud to have my kids. I'm glad my kids have been able to go to council schools. I am pleased with what they've been able to receive. Many of the problems we face as a district, as many of the changes I would like to see in the district, a lot of people like to see, can't come just from us. They are they require state changes and even federal changes. We'd have to work with other districts and people in other areas in order to make those happen. And I think that we could begin doing that. Especially if we could have more success if we could work within the policies that we have and try to come up with some creative solutions. I also would like to see again that as we have these policies, I'd like to be able to say for us to go to the teachers, the parents' meetings, and these are the rules they have to follow. This is what we have to do. This is where we want to go. How do you think we can get to where we want to go under the rules we have to follow? Do you have any ideas we haven't thought of? And how can we make this work? And I think that's, in general, the way we need to move forward.
Okay, Mr. Sharples, closing statement.
Well, I appreciate the opportunity to speak to everybody here tonight and the community at large. When I was a teacher, I did not see myself as a school board member, and my administration was the last thing I wanted to go into. I had my heart and soul at my core. I was a classroom teacher, and I loved what I did, and I couldn't imagine doing anything else. But now that I'm on the school board, it's grown on me a bit. You know, I've really come to enjoy serving the district in another capacity, and so I hope I continue or am able to continue to do that. And thanks very much.
Okay. So in summary, I'd like to thank the candidates for making the effort to come here. I'd like to thank the commissioners for letting us use this space. Our next forum will be here in this room Thursday, September 28th, again at 7 p.m. And this is for the council, city council positions. On Tuesday, October 10th, we will be in the, this will be in Longview City Hall. It will be the Longview School Board candidates. And then in Monday, October 23rd, in Longview City Council chambers.